cop right now. So we're gonna see what he fucking does.
Nothing.
Nothing? Alright, we're good. I only call you when it's high. Alright, it is an ungodly hour out right now, but we are up, baby. I was up at 1 a.m. It is currently 1:35 a.m. And we're just pre-tripping right now and just filling out a logbook. Get your pre-trip done?
Working out of bed.
How do you feel about this trip to Toronto, the 6?
Another day.
Yeah?
Yeah.
First stop. Dammy Hose, baby. We made it about 10 minutes outside of Carp and we had to stop for Tim Hortons. Come on. Oh, they're paving. Nighttime. Need a load of asphalt, bud? I'll go pick her up. All right, we almost made it to Toronto. We're gonna stop here. We're parked, not a truck stop. It's like the last en route. Got all these trucks here. We're gonna go get some coffee, stretch our legs. Beautiful. Hit a little bit of rain, but we're getting her. Look at that. The scales appear to be closed, so we might luck out, but no big deal. If we gotta go get weighed, we gotta go get weighed. So when we stopped, we were like, oh, let's check all the tires and stuff. And sure enough, that tire flat off the rim. So every tire shop is closed right now that I've Google searched. So we're gonna have to pull off to an area because we still gotta go a fair piece and find a tire guy that'll come out and fix this. Hawk. Yeah, just two cool lonely truckers waiting here for the tire guy. He's on his way though. Tire guy, shout out Cal Tire, guys. Shout out Cal Tire, man, saving our lives. He's on his way and we're just waiting for him. I messed up though. I kind of called a service number and then they called Cal Tire, so like I just paid a middleman to call Cal Tire when I could have just called Cal Tire. But whatever, I'm getting a tire and we're down and he's coming in 20 minutes. So that's awesome. And then we're like an hour away from our final destination. And then hopefully we don't blow another one. But like you guys are going through this heat wave too. Man, it is super hot up here. We're gonna hit like 100 degrees Fahrenheit again today. It's yummit. It's so yummit. All right, we'll catch up with you guys when we're on the road again.
Especially this one, it makes it easier. Those guys will see that and just go the fuck home.
Not you though. Not me. Take them off. You're the man. Are you Jake?
Matt.
Knew it was Matt. I was told on Instagram to ask for Jake. I'm like, nah, fuck, we got Matt. Okay, we are back on the road now. We're good to go. My phone's charging. We're an hour out. We'll see you guys when we are at the trailer spot. Look at that. That's the reflection. So we just went to go leave. All the paperwork's done. We paid the man, and we're just trying to figure out the brakes. So we tried to engage the brakes to see, and then there was numbers reading on the brake controller because it's an electric brake trailer, but it's an air brake vehicle. So we had our mechanic put a electronic brake switch underneath here, there, and there's a brake controller. And he's saying, the guy who built the trailer, that possibly the brake controller isn't big enough for the brakes. These are apparently the biggest electric brakes that you can get, and it's popping a fuse. So we got a guy over at another shop coming over to look at it so that we have brakes to drive home. So the saga continues. Nice trailer though. Here goes the maiden voyage. He's gonna go test the brakes. Wow, that looks awesome. Okay, so the trailer problem was actually the way that it was wired with our truck. He had too much power going to like two separate things. Anyways, it's all figured out, it's all solved. We are heading back. Homeward bound now. We are going to take the toll roads because it's quicker. There's a big accident in Toronto and we're not going to get jammed up here. We got to head back home. So we'll see you guys along the route. So we're going to head back home and yeah, that's what we're up to now. Maybe we'll stop, get some lunch in a little bit. We both want to get the F out of Toronto. Not that there's anything wrong with Toronto, but we're just let's get out of here. I forgot to mention, we are eastbound and down. And it's like, here, cringy as fuck, dude.
Eastbound and down, loaded up and trucking. Are we gonna do what they say can't be done? We've got a long way to go, and a short time to get there. I'm eastbound just like old Bandit Run. Keep your foot hard on the pedal.
I'm gonna turn down the AC so we can answer some questions. So I put it on Instagram. I wanted people to ask me some questions. They asked Andrew some questions too, so I'm gonna say a few. Some of my favorite ones that I saw. I got a lot of questions about the trailer, which I won't answer those questions because I'm just gonna go back to the yard and explain everything about the trailer and give you guys a walk around and why we bought it and the specs about it, at least what I know about it. To answer one, like one of the most asked questions were about like growth and where I see the company going, and basically like, you know, we're at the point that we're at now. First of all, how did we get there and how big do I want the company to grow to? You know, there's a lot of people in the whole world that have, you know, I don't want to talk just locally, but I feel like they grow too fast, they grow too quick. I've always been a fan of growing at like a super steady pace. Even though sometimes I get impatient, like this year you guys saw was a huge year for us. We bought a lot of stuff. Like we bought a dollar amount, around close to $1 million, if not a little more than $1 million that we invested into the company between trucks, trailers, dump trucks, pickup trucks, tools, excavators, skid steers, some stuff we haven't even gotten yet. Like we have a brand new black 257 that's supposed to show up next week. We bought another 306 next gen cat excavator, and a lot of you guys saw that in some of the Instagram posts. That 5-ton that we have now is a loaner until we get the new one. But as far as like getting to where we are now, it's been a steady progression, you know, since I really kind of didn't take control, well, kind of took control of like where I want to see the company grow and like where the end point is for me is like there really is no end point. If the work is there and the demand is there for the work, then I will keep growing accordingly to the supply. I don't want to outgrow the demand for work. I want to grow with the demand of work, if that makes sense. I don't want to just explode one year and then stuff kind of quiet down the next year, but I also don't want to be like pessimistic and think like, oh, everything's going to go to shit, so I don't want to invest, you know, and grow my company because, you know, the economy's going to fail. Well, I got to protect myself and grow in a way that I do cover myself. If the economy did fail, I could still make the payments and still make things go through.
but also not get to the point where, like, if something, you know, bad did happen, then I'd have to, like, send everything back. So, like, there is no end goal. I will keep growing this company, you know. I would love, like, to put a timeline on it, which I hate doing, but, like, I never get comfortable. Maybe 10 years from now, I'd like us to be, you know, maybe have 100 employees 10 years from now, because I'd be 36. 100, yeah. So, about 100 employees. Dump trucks, I'm not so much a fan of. I think they're awesome and you do need them, but if I want a dump truck, I'll just rent it from somebody else who's buying all the dump trucks. I like investing in equipment and manpower, women power, employees, because they can really alter your business. And I learned that when we hired Brad as an estimator, and just hiring some real key employees that help us out in the field and everything like that. So that answers up that question. I'll answer this one because I got this like probably 50 or 60 times. This is like the second most asked question. It was just advice for people that are either starting a company or looking to grow your company. I always refer back and say, I can't talk to you about how to start a business. I never started a company from zero, from scratch. The only business that I started from scratch was social media. Everybody starts at zero, and you have to look at it as a business. Even though it is a passion, it's fun, and I love doing it, and I would do it, well, I do it for no money because I don't make money off my videos anyways, but it is a business, there is a monetary value there. But as far as like starting your own company, I feel like there's a couple key important things. A couple cheesy things that I wanna first put out there is you gotta do what you love, because if you wake up every day and hate what you do, you will not succeed at it, I guarantee you that. You gotta have the passion and the love for it. That's like the first thing. Second thing that's like very important, that's not so much cheesy, but is figure out how to have cash flow and working capital. Those two things in construction, landscaping, whatever, we are in such a massive, heavy, overhead dominant industry. To buy a dump truck is $270,000 to rent it out for $90 an hour. Having working capital, having cash flow in your business to be able to sustain yourself and not be at the mercy of banks is something that's really important. So, and that took us like a long ass time to understand how to actually do that in a construction company. How can you put away cash and keep cash in the company to help float yourself so you're not at the mercy of your bank? But that being said, another one would be get a really good bank manager that wants to work with you with a construction, like a running line of credit. Beginning of the year, you're putting out all this money to get jobs, and you're normally about 90 days before you start seeing that money back into your company, so you got to kind of float yourself for a little bit. So it does help having a running line of credit. So those are like two main things I would say about starting your company. And work ethic. You have to have a serious, strong work ethic. You have to be able to want to miss out on family events, lose friends, upset your wives and girlfriends. I can't tell you, like, being totally honest with you guys, how many times, you know, I've had arguments with my girlfriend about not coming home on time, not being around enough, and that's just how it is. And she understands that, and if you're with somebody who understands that, then that's awesome. But there does come times when that becomes an argument, and like, you have to prepare yourself for that. Like, my business is my baby. Like, it sounds super terrible to say, but like, my business and my family are like on the same level, because without one there is no other. And I know that sounds bad when I say it, but it is true. Like, my business is my baby. So you have to have a strong work ethic and be able to understand that you're gonna miss out on stuff, and you gotta put in the time to really work for what you want. Obviously, you don't do what I originally hired you for, right?
Yeah.
How do you like operating the shovel versus being a truck driver, and what do you prefer doing?
I like running the shovel, but I do like driving truck. You did hire me to drive the dump truck, and then you just discovered that I could run a shovel, so I don't know. It doesn't really matter. I just like doing multiple things. Changes it up every day kind of thing. So.
Yeah, and like, there's been multiple times this trip where we've passed, like, Andrew is a truck guy, like, through thick and thin, and, like, we've talked about it before, like, next year, I would like to buy a new tractor and float setup, and, like, you know, I probably will take another employee that we have that's currently running the shovel today, he'll probably run and move up to the 325 with rototill, and Andrew will do, like, our floating and stuff. It's like, you're just, you like trucks, you're a truck guy.
Yeah, no, I like trucks.
Good one. Tommy Cockett at 04 asks, Andrew, how did you get into construction?
My father, he was in it right from when I was born. He worked for one guy for 20 years, and I started there when I was 17. And he gave me the chance to get on the machines, and basically once I ran every machine there is to run, like, I got my license to start driving a truck. Kept going from there.
What's it like, you know, working at Kenway Construction? Like, is it interesting? Is it different, like, compared to another place, other places that you've worked in the past? Like, what is it about it that, you know, keeps you still here?
Well, like, it's something new every day. There's always something different to do. You're not doing the same boring thing. Like, there's always, like, it's fun to come to work and do these projects and see, like, what you can get accomplished. Like, when you go in and do a whole septic in 2 days and you, like, look at it and you're like, holy shit, like, you did that. Like, it's a good feeling. And that's what we do every day.
Yeah.
Northumberland is actually the county of Northumberland. En route, we're gonna stop for a bite to eat. Got a truck here. Oh, look at that Kenworth. That's beauty. Everything's running good. We're running a little hot. The front axle's running a little hot too, but everything seems to be looking good. Lights are on. Lights are all working. Andrew says, I gotta take you to this really, really cool place I know. See a massive chrome shop sign on the highway. 5 minutes, he says. Yeah, we'll see.
Andrew's 5 minutes in the chrome shop turned into about 20 minutes and $500. But one thing that I did get that I'm super pumped about is a tire checker, which goes awesome with today because we blew a tire and Andrew forgot to check his tires this morning. Okay, maybe not. We're almost back home. We're just coming through. We just passed Joyceville. Anybody out here knows Joyceville? Comment down below. We're in Crosby right now, past the Joyceville Penitentiary, where all the bad men and women go. Actually, probably just men. It's not a women's prison, is it?
I don't know.
Are men and women in the same prison?
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, is that a whole equals thing? No, they're definitely not. No. Hell no. No, yeah, no. Yeah, no. Okay, we're almost home.
Okay, it is now the next week. We are back here, and I know that I said Friday, and I posted on the on YouTube community, so you guys could see, like, a post that I put up. Last week, we had something tragic happen in the family. My brother-in-law ended up passing away at 28 years old. He ended up getting into an accident, and he lost his life, and leaving behind my sister with their unborn child, and yeah, I don't want to get too much into it because I'm still kind of grieving over it. But I did want to show you guys the trailer and go over it. So we actually had a guy come in last week. So this is an 18-ton, 3-axle electric brake trailer. Now, we had a guy come in last week and measure this all up. So our tandem that pulls it, it's good for 46,000 kg gross. So we'll be able to put something in the tandem as well as around 16-ton on the actual float. So kind of talk about what's on it. Going over the front, it's pendle hitch float. That's obviously for all the wiring, brakes, and everything like that. There's a nice cubby underneath here so we can put some, well, ratchet straps, chalk blocks, and chains. So that's up here. One cool thing about the trailer that we got him to do is because we mainly got this for hydro work, And with hydro work, a lot of the time is you really need to make sure that everything is like, they're really strict on safety, which we always are, but when you're on a residential site sometimes, but there's really no exceptions when you're doing hydro work. So we have strobes wired in. There's a battery on this that actually runs. So when we're disconnected from the truck, the lights on the trailer will still work, which is super cool. I ordered some beacons from Amazon for here. Milano Trailers, shout out them for building this trailer custom for us. They put in these pod lights here, which I'll flick on. So that's running off the battery. That's not hooked up to anything right now. So at nighttime, you'll be able to see what we're throwing in. Got this awesome headache rack built. I'm going to be matting this so that these don't kind of rattle and slam against it. So we're going to be putting some horse stall mats up against here. Slots for rakes and shovels, which is awesome. Turn off these lights. Two-speed jack. Just a wood deck. Got our custom flaps on there already. These are awesome. They're just spring loaded. They're super easy to put down and throw back up. So that's great. Those beacons there and there, they remain on when you have the beacons on, as well as the two at the very front. So that when you're pulled over, like I was just explaining. But yeah, I mean, if anybody has any more questions about the actual trailer, this is going to be good. It can haul the skid steer, the 308, the 306, our dozer, our roller. Lots of different pieces of equipment that we'll be able to go on this and take to the job site rather than taking our big float just for little stuff. Well, thank you guys for watching the video a little longer. Hopefully you guys learned a little bit with the questions and answers today. Thank you guys for watching. Have an awesome week. Take care. Desperado. But of course, I didn't forget about you guys, the true patriots of the channel that watch the entire video to the very end, which is right now. And if you are one of those true patriots, I want you guys to comment down below, just tag it. Why just tag it? Well, we picked up a beautiful tag trailer from Milano Trailer. Shout out them for doing an awesome job making this trailer for us. So if you guys watch the entire video to the end, comment down below, just tag it. I appreciate you guys. We'll catch you on the next one. Take care. Never know, no, just one.